Welcome to the podcast series on National Education Policy 2020 by the Center of Excellence in Teacher Education Initiative at Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. For this podcast, we plan to interview educationists and other stakeholders to share their responses and insights on different chapters of the education policy. Over to our host of today.
So today's session is about foundational numeracy. So we have Professor Dr. Arindam Bose with us. Arindam Bose is an associate professor at Center of Education, Innovation and National Research, CEIAR, TIS Mumbai. He is the team lead mathematics team in Connected Learning Initiative, CLICS project, and a coordinator of Science and Mathematics Education Group, CEIAR. He is also the faculty coordinator of MA Education course, TIS Mumbai. I welcome you, sir, and thank you for your time, sir.
Thank you.
I would request you to, sir, give your opinion on the foundational literacy and numeracy part from the NEP 2020.
Thank you, Ashish, for this opportunity and for this invitation. Coming to the point directly, foundation literacy and numeracy is discussed in the current draft of National Education Policy 2020 in a very small paragraph, rather, on page 8 and page 9. And it appears to me, or would appear to anyone who is engaged in mathematics education research, as a very cursorily written part, you know, and it's not even making it clear as to what foundation numeracy is. Of course, in section 2.1, which is part of foundational literacy and numeracy and an urgent and necessary prerequisite to learning, it mentions that numeracy is, and I quote, the ability to write and comprehend basic text and the ability to carry out basic addition and subtraction with Indian numerals. Well, so there are many questions which emerge from here. What we mean by numeracy, is it only about the ability to read and write and to comprehend and only to carry out basic operations and that too with Indian numerals? So these are some of the questions which come to our minds. The point is that I would like to bring forth here is when we talk about assessment and the ways to measure whether a child has really, you know, picked up numeracy and foundational literacy, as the policy mentions, then what are those measures? You know, how would those measures look like? Because there are many data. In fact, even my own research indicates that even grade 6 children are not able to write. In fact, more than 50% of my sample students were not able to write 4-digit numbers correctly, or even 5-digit numbers correctly. But and therefore, the operations based on these numbers were also not very, very correct to the extent that generally is expected at that stage. And I'm not even talking about early childhood care and education or preschool stage. So you can wonder. However, the point to be noted here is, even those children about whom I said they were not able to write 4-digit numbers, they were actually able to take out equivalent amount of money from any source. You know, you give them a bunch of different denominations of currency and ask them to take out that much of amount of money. For example, if you say, and I'm just giving you an example, 2,725, most children of that age would actually know that 2,725 actually means that you take out 500 rupee notes and so on. That makes 2,500 and so on. And they can actually give you that much amount of money. Now, Ashish, my point is, if they are able to do that, which actually means that they know numeracy, right? We can't claim that the child doesn't have numeracy knowledge just because the child is not able to write those numbers properly in the way we want them to write. They may actually write 2,725. Now, we want them to write producing the decimal representation, making sure that the place values are intact. But I don't think, this is my personal opinion, and this is also reflected in many research literature, this is not a true reflection of whether the child has really attained numeracy knowledge. You see? So therefore, my take here, as you asked, Ashish, about foundational literacy and numeracy, I think we have to, the policy should have been more clear on this. You know, there are many students who are in danger of getting labeled as they are not, they have not attained foundational literacy or numeracy just because they're not able to write those properly or they're not able to carry out operations in the way we want. Yeah, I fear that.
The policy defines foundational numeracy as the ability to carry out basic addition and subtraction with Indian numerals, right? So do you think this definition is apt for defining foundational numeracy?
I find it a bit limiting. You know, it's not just about, as I just mentioned and explained a while ago, it's not about the ability to read and comprehend basic text or ability to carry out basic addition and subtraction and so on. You know, it's more than that. You know, in fact, so many of those children about whom I was describing, who were able to, you know, identify different denominations of money, you know, and they could calculate, they could add, subtract, you know, do whatever operations you want, you know, using different denominations of currency, which indicates that they were able to operate, you know, according to the definition, they are able to fulfill those. But if you ask them to write them down, you know, write those numbers down or, you know, do in a written form, probably they wouldn't be able to do. And this is why I say that, you know, there is a danger that many of these, and I think we are repeating the same error that we used to do before. And to me, this appears as, you know, old wine in the new bottle. Nothing beyond that.
Yes, so I feel the policy is actually limiting because the policy does not include the data of the number of students outside school who may have attended foundational numeracy. So how do you think the policy is looking at universalization of foundational numeracy?
Well, I really doubt that. If universalization of education is dependent on numeracy and foundational literacy, well, then I have nothing to say. This is very hilarious. You know, it's universalization of elementary education, which has been the demand of, you know, various quarters of the country, not just some of the NGOs or, you know, activists and so on. It would be very diluted form in the way the policy looks at it at the present. And if we try to, you know, cater to some of these ideas. An example of that is in section 2.2, it says, attaining foundational literacy and numeracy for all children will thus become an urgent national mission. Why does it say that it will become as if it is not a mission right now? You see? I would hope rather that when you talk about, and as you said, universalization of elementary education or universalization of, you know, at least foundational literacy and numeracy. This is not the first time that we are talking about it. We have attained independence 75 years ago almost. And there has been past attempts. There has been many other national curriculum frameworks. There were many other national education policies. I think there is a need to look back and see what worked and what did not work. And if something did not work, then why did those not work? Because many of those were good attempts. It's not that we are doing these things for the first time. So therefore, when section 2.2 says, attaining foundational literacy and numeracy for all children will thus become an urgent mission, it sort of takes into an account, it sort of says that, well, it has never been that mission and we are starting it for the first time. And that is deplorable, according to me. I don't agree. I don't buy this statement. You know, we have been part of this. There has been national education mission. There has been mission on, you know, there has been attempts and missions and so on. In fact, the phrase that you used, universalization of education. Is an old phrase, it's not new, right? So I really doubt if universalization of elementary education or even foundational literacy should be linked with only knowledge of literacy and numeracy and not beyond that. So what is it about universalization, you know? And secondly, I think if we look at it from this perspective, it will be limiting the cause of universalization, you know, universalizing of elementary education in that sense.
True, sir. I mean, the NEP kind of highlights about foundational literacy and numeracy, and it recognizes it as the urgent and necessary prerequisite to learning. It states that the other section, the policy is relevant to the students only if the most basic learning requirement, that is reading, writing and arithmetic at foundational level, is first achieved. So do you think this basic literacy and numeracy are prerequisite to learning?
Well, on one hand, that's true, you know, these are prerequisite. But the point is the way this portrays, you know, if you carry forward that definition of numeracy, which was put in 2.1, then that will be very limiting. And, you know, if I look at examples of children from, particularly coming from disadvantaged communities, tribal groups, and communities which really valorize work contexts. So children who have an exposure to work context knowledge or have an exposure to microenterprise, household-based microenterprises, where they are dealing a lot with not just different denominations of currency, but also different produce, products, you know, they are part of that community practice of producing different kinds of goods, part of the microenterprise. Now, for them, for those children, the notion of literacy and numeracy is different. That's what I'm trying to say. That in 2.1, if we only restrict definition of numeracy as ability to read and comprehend, ability to read and read numbers and carry out basic operations, mathematical, arithmetical operations, that will be too restrictive and too limiting. Because often children from such background as I described just now, they bring to the fore, in fact, they bring to the classroom so much of diverse knowledge practices from their community, which we refer to as knowledge resource or funds of knowledge of the community, which even children, young children, have access to, because those are seen as something which is valorized and which are seen as important to learn. Now, in those contexts, this limiting definition of numeracy and foundational literacy would be very dangerous, because coming from this perspective, most likely those children will always be treated as if they have not attained it, you see. As I said, you know, I'm repeating once again, children even from grade 6, who were 11 years old, 12 years old, were not able to write 4-digit or 5-digit numbers, but they could carry out mathematical operations very, very correctly, all mental operations. They could actually identify the number, you know, by treating the number as amount of money. For those groups of children, a number is actually an amount of money to be distributed, to be added, you know, to be, you know, stacked together, and what kind of, all kinds of, you know, every arithmetical operation has a meaning, you see. Even division has a meaning, like distribution of money among so many people. Subtraction has a meaning, you know, you deduct your profit or you deduct your wage and you give up, whatever, you know, there are interpretations. The point is, it would be too limiting if we simply look at what the policy says as a way to identify or see whether numeracy is attained or foundational literacy is attained. And so this could lead to different, you know, diverse other problems. In fact, we will be then ending up reinventing the same wheel as we have been doing already. So I don't see any way or in any manner in which the policy takes us further. It's rather reinventing the same wheel. Over to you.
Yeah, so I was saying it is very true that it is the limiting nature of the definition of foundational literacy, which does not actually acknowledge the resource which comes with the student. So My question is setting 2025 as the target year for universalization, so universal attainment of foundational numeracy, a realistic target? So as you said, like, you know, what were we doing before this policy? Are we actually, were we like focusing on foundational numeracy or not? So is it possible in this given time frame that, you know, by 2025, we should attain foundational numeracy?
Well, it's difficult to say, but, you know, universalization of elementary education as part of SSA, Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, you know, it was part, and we could not meet that goal, you know, and so setting up a five-year target is, of course, good, ambitious, and but I keep my fingers crossed and with a pinch of salt, because unless we really gear up to find true meaning of, you know, numeracy, you know, just for the sake of having on record that, well, we have attained it, we might actually, but will that really add to comprehension and understanding, is what I'm saying. In fact, on one hand, there are children, like middle class, children belonging to middle class families, often are able to perhaps write a number or copy a number from the book and carry out operations and so on, without even understanding what the arithmetical sum, the problem asked for, because they knew that a similar task, which is was solved on the board, on the whiteboard or blackboard by the teacher, was done in so many steps, following so many rules, or, you know, that many operations, a child may be able to do that, you know, exactly copy the steps and copy down the numbers without even knowing what they're doing. Now, here is an example where we will say probably that, well, the child has attained numeracy because the child is able to write, you know, a number and also carry out basic operations, arithmetical operations. On the other hand, the example that I gave where the child was not even able to write a number, if you dictate it, if you ask them to write 2725, probably they wouldn't write 2725 and something else. But they actually understand how much that amount is. That numberness, you know, that how much is 2725, you know, that meaning of that number, you know, how much it carries, you know, the value of it, you know, that numberness is something which I believe must be attached with numeracy, because numeracy is not just knowing a number. A knowledge about numeracy is not about being able to write the number or being able to carry out operation, but it also must include comprehension. So I'm not sure if 5 years is a realistic target. It is certainly ambitious, and one, why wouldn't one hope for it, you know? Always, you know, we are all academic researchers, we hope for the best of the country, for our citizens. I would rather keep my fingers crossed for this, but I don't see that to be a realistic target.
Yes, sir. So we had like various programs like SSA or DPEP, you know, in the past, where they talked about universalization of primary education, but which is still not achieved. So I also believe that it's not a realistic target to achieve by 2025. My question is, the policy envisions its implementation according to the stage-wise grade target. What if the child does not attend foundational numeracy in the subsequent grades, like, you know, the new 5+3+3 model, and they are saying like by grade 3, the child should achieve foundational literacy and numeracy. So how do you think policy is addressing this situation? What if the child does not attend even by grade 3?
I have no answer for that, Ashish, mainly because the policy is silent on that part. You know, it doesn't really say what will happen to a child. So is the child going to be detained at grade 3 at that stage and not promoted? Or does the child carry along that baggage of non-comprehension, you know, carry along that backlog, you know, in further classes? So that tension will remain, you know, and that tension remains anyway, you know, at every stage. So I don't see that as a major challenge as well, because often that stays, and sometimes with further exposure or further, you know, attunement to that kind of an exposure or practice in higher grades, often children develop that comprehension later on and clear those backlog. That is possible. That happens. So I would rather hope for that. But yes, the policy is silent on it.
Yes, it's like the missing part of the puzzle where I mean, the policy is not talking about, like, if the child has a learning disability, what about them, you know? So there are various questions which comes with this.
Absolutely, so Ashish. In fact, sorry to interrupt you. Absolutely, you're right. In fact, reading the policy, one feels that it's keeping that child from a middle class, urban child from a middle class family in the focus. And the policy is, you know, created keeping that child in mind. There is no mention, or if we envisage a child from disadvantaged communities, from communities which have, say, living in low income, you know, huge low income settlements in every big city has, you know, with immigrants from different other states. You know, look at Delhi, look at Mumbai, look at any other metropolitan town where we have large influx of immigrants from different states, right? And the COVID pandemic has emerged that, in fact, it has indicated to us that division even more, right? And the policy doesn't seem to be speaking to children of those families. Keep aside or forget about other groups like tribals or people from different other disadvantaged communities, or not to talk about children with special needs. These are not being addressed. So that is I think it's a very, seen from a very limiting perspective. It brings out that limiting perspective and doesn't really do justice to every part of the population.
So the policy talks about the training teachers and literate adults to attend the foundational literacy and numeracy. So what changes are you expecting in the redesign of teacher education?
Well, there are two things, Ashish. First, this perspective, you know, which is quite Vygotskian perspective, coming from socio-cultural approach, if they're really doing that, you know, the most knowledgeable other. But that happens even now. There's nothing new about it. As I said, you know, communities which valorize work context, hand skills, and valorize their funds of knowledge, their knowledge resource, which is there in the as part of the community culture, and which they find as an important resource to be imparted to the newer generation. Who do you think is actually doing this, imparting literacy and numeracy knowledge to the children? Of course, there are people around the child in the community from that, because you see in those communities, a house, there's a different concept of home and family. The entire community can be a child's family. And it's just a larger family set. And there are others apart from teachers who are doing this. In fact, when I was giving those examples, who do you think the child learned about handling currency denominations and so on? Obviously, not in the school. So such things are always going on, already been happening, but has not been acknowledged in the policy. Rather, it says that other people will be appointed or trained to impart numeracy and literacy trainings. Now, I fear for the teachers. Does that mean that teacher cadre will be diluted? There is a danger of that, Ashish. So therefore, on one hand, I really decry that the policy has not acknowledged this fact that in India, if you come from any part of the country, you know, be it tribal, be it children coming from immigrant families and so on, there is a culture already in place where such knowledge, you know, part of community practice and culture is already being imparted to children by the community elders or whoever. As I said, it's a big family. But now if we start diluting it and giving training to anybody, you know, who we think is fit for becoming a teacher, then I think there's a danger. Already, you see, to teach primary school, primary classes, we have in place the system where a student who has cleared 12th, grade 12, passed grade 12, and does 1 or 2 years of diploma in elementary education or diploma in education. You know, these are the two terminologies. which means grade 12 plus 1 year or 2 years of learning, become eligible to teach in primary section. So I would say that already we have something very dangerous in place. You know, primary grades are those period where children actually need very, very experienced hands. And who would disagree to that? Rather than providing experienced teachers to that group of children, we have already diluted it and made DLED as a mandatory criterion to appoint teachers. And this policy, I'm saying that it is becoming even more, setting an even more dangerous precedence by even diluting that and just saying that anybody or everybody on the street can be invited and trained and they would impart numeracy knowledge and literacy knowledge. I totally discard this and decry. This is hilarious. This is atrocious. And I don't know where it comes from. Who gives these ideas? Where is this idea drawn from? Another thing, it's an academic, if it is an academic document, the policy must actually refer some of the literature, some of the research literature, or cite some documents where these ideas have been taken from, which the policy doesn't. The policy also doesn't take into account what previous policies could not attain or what previous policies did or could not do. I ask, why was this policy even needed at the first place? Something did not happen in the past, that's why, isn't it? If something did not happen in the past, why didn't you make it clear what did not happen, what went wrong, and let us try to address that and not dilute things which are already in place? I think we need a policy which strengthens our system, which strengthens our government school system, public education system, and not dilute them.
I agree, sir. Like the primary education, primary students, initially, I feel, where is this coming from, that the primary school students should, you know, the teacher, what about the qualification, who decides this? I am not about it. Also, you're very right when you said, like, we need more trained hands when it comes to primary education, which is because it is very crucial. So my next question, sir, is the policy kind of addresses two kind of students here, just like the NCF 2005, where they say, narrow goals and higher goals. So what do you think, how the policy is catering to the needs of these two types of students, which they are differentiating?
I'm not really getting your question, Ashish. Can you repeat it? Sorry.
So the policy understands two learning levels here. Okay. The students who need foundational literacy and numeracy, and one who have already achieved it. So both the students here, how is the policy catering to their needs?
Well, you mean two different groups, one group from the preparatory phase and then the next stage. Is it that what you're asking? Well, I don't see even that division of stages, 5+3+3+4. I think that is already in place. In fact, we have the concept of Anganwari, the present preparatory phase, which is for 5 years, which will include 3 years of preschool and 2 years of grade 1 and grade 2. Well, that is welcome. But the point is, Anganwari system actually does it. But yes, it's nice to see that now this is being formalized and it will be part of schooling system, which is nice. But nowhere, if we try to see in the document what it mentions about Anganwari system, it only says, it talks about Anganwari system, that the workers or teachers who are working already in those systems, they will be trained through a systematic effort in accordance with the curricular and pedagogical framework as developed by NCERT. Yeah, and it says, further says, and I'm quoting, that Anganwari workers or teachers with qualification of 10 plus 2 and above shall be given a 6-month certificate program in ECCE. Well, ECCE is a very well-defined concept with so much of research happening and so much of literature available, I don't see the policies actually, you know, drawing some of those ideas from the from research or carrying forward some of these. It is coming as a very superficially written as a 6-month program. What would that 6-month certificate program mean? What will it entail? Who's going to decide that? All these are not written. And therefore, coming back to your question about different groups of students, I'm not really clear. I'm not getting a clear picture from the policy. So therefore, I can only say that some of it is already part of the system. It's giving a new, a new name, you know, a new nomenclature, a new categorization. Even the categorization was there earlier, right? We used to say lower primary, upper primary, and so on. So there's not much change, you know, as being portrayed. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Actually, my question was, you have answered it, but I would like to repeat the question. So the policy understands students of 2 learning levels, one with the foundational numeracy and one without. So my question was, what do you think how policy is catering to the needs of both these types of students?
Well, that has to be, I don't see that being catered to, but I also know that policy alone cannot do everything, you see. It would be too ambitious on our part to expect everything from the policy. See, based on the policy, curricular frameworks are drawn. So now to answer your question, Ashish, we'll have to wait and see how the national curriculum framework, the new framework which is being prepared, as I have heard, or as we understand. Now we have to wait and see how the NCF, the new NCF, will interpret the policy and to answer this question, you know, to address this. So not everything policy prescribes, no, but it indicates. But the problem is the policy does not indicate in clear words, right? So it will be dependent on how it's interpreted by those who are preparing the NCF document. So it will be contingent on their decision. Yeah.
Surely, sir, when the framework comes out, it will be more clear, like how the policy is, you know, envisioning things. So yeah. My next question, sir, is, do you think the dependence of student learning and teacher education on a online platform called Diksha for foundational literacy is problematic in some way? Are we assuming this digital platform or infrastructure accessible to all?
Well, digital platforms have their own affordances, and it's good that we are gearing up towards meaningful use of technology. So that is really good. But catering to the needs of children of that age group who are very, very small, like at the preschool stage or early school stage, you know, preparatory stage, because that's where you introduce foundational literacy and numeracy. I'm not sure how much technology platform can be of help at that stage, you know, for those children. I understand, you know, some of these online channels or technology enabled platforms are really useful, and that's where we also need to pitch in, keeping in mind the question of access and digital divide, which are there, you know, very, very rampant, very, very apparent. Nonetheless, it's important that we also keep on exploring effectiveness of, use of technology and their affordances. But I'm not really sure how would Diksha platform cater to the needs of children that small, you know, at the preschool and early school level. I'm not really, really sure about that. Over to you.
Yes, sir, because most of the students, like even in the pandemic, people do not have internet, devices to, you know, learn something, most of them. Our population mostly stays in villages. So
Ashish, cutting you short, for children who live in urban areas, you know, a child of age 5, 6, 7 up to that, you know, because preparatory stage is great till, it's going to be till grade two, right? So you are talking about children from age 3 till age 7, literally. Those 5 years, age 3, age 4, age 5, age 6, age 7, 5 years. I don't know, even if even urban children of that age would actually make any sense from Diksha platform, you know, make any sense when where there is no hand holding, or will they have, you know, there will be attention deficiency. How do you retain their interest? How do you, you know, because you, we all understand children of that age, that small, say age 3, age 4, at age 5, there is attention deficiency as well. They could be interested in many things and not just look at the platform, at the screen, right? How do you, in fact, even for adults, it's very difficult to even stick to the screen all the time watching it. So I do not know if it is even viable to even think of it, or in what ways it's being thought of. Well, if through Diksha platform, we think of imparting TPD, teacher professional development workshops or trainings, and they in turn do it for the children, then that's a different question. All right, over to you.
Yes, sir. Because most of the adults also like suffer using the technology, this application, this new application coming up. So drawing back from the concept of more knowledgeable others, which is not new, you said. So one of the section also talks about one-on-one peer tutoring to be extremely effective for learning and mentoring of the child. So according to you, what could be the nature of learning in such a setting? Will it be dialogic or democratic or hierarchical in nature? What do you think about it?
Well, it depends. Who is our peer? Again, you see the policy doesn't, it falls short of defining the peer. You know, is the peer my classmate? Is the peer a few years senior to me in the same school? Who is my peer? Or is the peer my friend from the community? Now, if we talk about such peers, like friends from communities or elders in the community or my, you know, my co-workers in the community, that's already been happening. That's what, you know, anthropologists and cultural psychologists like Jean Lave, Barbara Rogoff, you know, they have been saying. Guided participation is that's what guided participation is. So it depends which peer we are referring to. I'm not clear on that. In fact, policy doesn't mention about it clearly.
So the policy highlights that the enjoyable and inspirational books will be available in local languages. Do you think this is contextualization? Will it help students to better comprehend the content of the book?
Any book, you know, any book with many pictures, many real life examples, contextualized examples, will be joyful, you know. Children enjoy those books. So it's a good idea that, you know, if we try to present many such books and resources and make these available to the larger population, you know, disadvantaged communities and so on. But the problem is, again, Ashish, interpretation. How the word inspirational books will be interpreted, you know, by those who are framing NCF or those who are writing. You know, there's always a danger of such, you know, open-ended or vague terminologies. This is quite vague as of now. What does it mean by saying inspirational? Is it about someone's autobiography, or someone's biography? Is it going to be about some religious figures coming from theology? Is it going to be about some characters from some movie, some sport? What is it? This could be interpreted in several other ways, you know. So I'm not sure what it really means.
Yes, sir. It was actually not clear why they are including this part, like inspirational book stories and you know, numeracy part. Not clear at all. So any concluding thoughts on how the section on numeracy could have been better envisioned? by the policy?
I would have expected that, you know, some of the recent literature, research literature, was referred to. In fact, some of the research literature coming from India or in similar contexts in other countries, from even those nations who have done really well in attaining numeracy and literacy, like South Asian countries, Southeast Asian countries, Singapore, Taiwan, or even Scandinavian countries like Finland, Sweden, Denmark, and so on. If we could have referred to some of those success stories, listen to what research documents say. Policy currently is completely silent on it. It comes from a very superficial, you know, from a very common sense knowledge perspective. These are some of the very, I would say, very important ideas of child psychology or child's cognitive development, right? And this can't be just catered to by commonsensical knowledge, but rather it should be backed up by good research literature and review of those, which I think is missing currently in the present form.
Thank you, sir. I have no more questions to ask. So it was great talking to you, sir. We got many insights and different perspectives to look at the policy. Thank you for your time. I surely believe this insights will, you know, give us like very different perspective to think and read the policy differently. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ashish, for the opportunity. Thank you very much.
That is all for today. We will be back with another episode shortly. This podcast is brought to you by the Center for Excellence in Teacher Education Initiative at Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. Thank you for listening. Have a good day.